If you want to know how things are going with Israel and Palestine, well, pretty much how you expect and pretty much how we predicted. Loss of life has continued to escalate. The US has completely abdicated any sort of political or strategic or diplomatic or moral leadership. And there are some good people in US government speaking up for peace and for the civilians that are being slaughtered every single day. But they, of course, have very little political power. But let's catch up a bit on what's going on. Diplomatic efforts appeared stalled as the level of destruction was quickly escalating to the kind of violence that had not been seen since the last major conflict way back in 2014. That was a battle that ultimately claimed 2,200 lives, rendered large areas of the Gaza Strip uninhabitable. You know, very little had actually been repaired in terms of electrical and, you know, water infrastructure, of course. By the way, you know, so that was a quote from the New York Times, which, by the way, their coverage is fine on this topic. But they reference there a battle that ultimately claimed 2,200 lives. And I thought, wait a second, where's the breakdown on that, buddy? And so, yeah, no, more than 2,100 of those 2,200 were Palestinians. The vast majority civilians who'd been killed. On the Israeli side, there were 64 soldiers and 6 civilians who were killed. So that is a 70 to more than 2,100, which fits the historic pattern. And it reminded me, by the way, of a comment I saw from a professor, Rashid Khalidi, who was on Democracy Now! Over the last week, who said, one wonders what proportion you have of Arab deaths, of Palestinian deaths over Israeli deaths. Is it 20-1 before the US finally begins to recognize that this is not legitimate self-defense? This is a perfect illustration of the bias that has been a feature of American policy for many, many years. That is a perfectly valid sort of philosophical hypothetical. But apparently in past conflicts, no, that sort of ratio is not enough. Now, we're not there quite yet. In the past week, though, nearly 200 Palestinians have been killed in the most recent violence, more than 50 of whom were children. And Sunday, just yesterday, was the deadliest day, with at least 42 people killed, including at least 10 children, after an attack on a tunnel network caused 3 buildings to collapse. So, Francesca, that's the way that it's going right now. What are your thoughts?
Well, I think it's devastating, and it is sadly so common when it comes to the way that Israel fights and the way that Israel is hell-bent on its ultimate goal, you know, which is ethnic cleansing, which is, hey, Palestinians, just move or die. Or die very slowly. That's why we won't give you access to the COVID-19 vaccine. Perfect. See how this all works? And so this is, once again, we're calling for a ceasefire. I do think a ceasefire is important. But at the same time, we have to understand that there is no such thing as a status quo in Israel-Palestine. That status quo is continual displacement, is continual ethnic cleansing, is continually Palestinians living on smaller and smaller swaths of land, losing their homes, of becoming refugees in the world without the ability to return. That is the status quo. It is settlements from the Israeli side continuing to encroach into the West Bank. So remember, even if and when, and man, I do hope there is a ceasefire soon. I do hope this is not a repeat of 2014. I hope that the world's outrage, which I do think is a little bit more unified this time around, we'll stop this sooner than getting to that 2,000 number or more. But again, we just have to continue to remember, like, what is at the root of this. And the other thing is, you know, we're going to talk about it, but Israel's been targeting, they've been targeting journalists. They've been targeting emergency workers. They've been targeting civilians. This is how they do, right? This is par for the course. This isn't about a military versus another military, because Palestine doesn't have a military, right? Like, that's just what happens. And when you talk about Gaza, let's remember, this is the most populated place on earth. It is the most, that's why people call it an open air prison, right? Because it's surrounded by Israeli military, and there are people packed in there. So it is, you could argue that it would be a human rights crime or violation to even strike anywhere in Gaza, because the chances that you are going to kill civilians is incredibly high. That being said, Israel knows exactly where journalists and civilians and emergency workers live. And finally, last thing, I'm sorry to say, but it's been about 7 or 8 days now. Maybe I think today might be the 9th day of the siege on Gaza. You guys, people aren't getting in. There is no access for the outside world to get in and help Gaza. This is Gaza by itself. Yes, there are aid organizations. Yes, there can be money in, but in terms of like what would be the humanitarian thing, which is opening the inroads into Gaza, that is not possible right now. That is incredibly difficult. Humanitarian workers, journalists are not allowed in.
Yeah. Yeah, and in that way is largely a continuation of the status quo before blockade, you know, both economic and in terms of you know, necessary medical aid, which was cruel and inhuman, a violation of fundamental human rights before the pandemic, let alone during it. And you systematically destroy the media's ability to accurately describe what's happening there. You're referencing there over the weekend, they destroyed the building housing Al Jazeera's bureau. That adds on to a long list of the AP and a number of other media outlets whose headquarters have all been, they just all happen to be near Hamas, I guess. And you know, a bunch of absolute troglodytes in right-wing media spent the weekend on social media applauding the destruction of these media headquarters. But yeah, I totally agree with what you said though about like even the road to a ceasefire, which we'll get to. Are we calling for one? We'll talk about that. But what we are calling for potentially is a return to the status quo, but not a return to peace. That's the way it's presented by the mainstream media. But to believe that would require a great deal of ignorance about what the actual situation was. It wasn't peace, it wasn't justice. There was nothing humane about the lives that Gazans were forced to live before the most recent bombing campaigns. And the best case scenario right now, horrifically, is a return to that horror, which I guess is preferable to the widespread loss of civilian life that we're seeing on a daily basis now. And one of the terrors of doing a show like this is just wondering, like, while we're doing this, we're not on social media, we're not tracking the news. And I don't know about you, Francesca, but I'm just always horrified. What's happening right now that I'm not seeing? What apartment complex is being destroyed? What, you know, a provider of medical devices in Gaza is being blown up? You know, what home in a refugee camp is being bombed? And that's happening right now.
Yeah, I mean, and then that's, yeah, the other thing is just to remember, like, refugee camps have been bombed. A man lost his entire family in a refugee camp. What more do you want from people? How much more are Gazans and Palestinians supposed to sacrifice? Like, what is acceptable? And I think you talked about this, you know, the ratio. So what if we get to zero Israeli deaths and 100 Palestinians? Is that acceptable? My guess is no, because that's not part of the plan. The plan is, no, Palestinians deserve it. No matter how many have to die, they deserve it because they are terrorists. End of story. That is exactly the narrative. And that is exactly the project of sort of militarized nation building that Israel sadly participates in, right? There is no good faith two-state solution that is done with. It is not even physically possible at this point, right? And so once again, like remembering there is no line, there is no acceptable resistance. There is no, okay, well, if you just throw rocks, guys, remember what happens when children throw rocks in the West Bank? They are open fired upon. This last week, 13 Palestinians died in the West Bank, protesting, peaceful protests. I mean, throwing rocks. So again, this is, I mean, we don't need a stretch of the imagination in the United States here when you see peaceful demonstrators, you know, all throughout the summer protesting for Black lives and against police brutality being met with police brutality. Exactly. Well, you multiply that by, you know, 73 years and a whole lot more weaponry, and there you go.
Yeah. For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.